Thanksgiving. Yum.
What up, dudes? Welcome back to the Yo Video Games Podcast. I'm Matt.
And I'm Andrew.
And today we're going to talk about the five games we think everybody should play at some point in their life. So this was kind of like something everyone likes to talk about. And everyone knows me in this. I'm kind of like the cynical, curmudgeon-y, you know, just I hate everything.
That's kind of a dick.
Yeah. That's the thing. And like, you know, you like to propagate that yourself. Like, you hate this, you hate that. You know, I hate Western RPGs. I don't hate Western RPGs. You hate sports games. I don't hate sports games. Everyone thinks I hate everything, which is not true.
You hate John Madden, and you hate sports ball.
I don't hate sports ball.
You hate Christmas.
I do. Well,
and happiness.
That's right. Well, okay, happiness maybe. But I don't hate everything. We're going to see today that I do, in fact, love some things, and I just don't love everything. So okay. Do you want to... Now, how do you... I don't know how you want to go about this. Now, do you want to talk about... You want to bring up the first game, or do you want me to go with the first game?
Okay, I'll open up with the first game. I'm going to say for, like, my number five.
Okay.
Borderlands 2.
Borderlands 2.
Why should everybody play it? One, because it is Borderlands 1 with a better story. And Borderlands isn't... It doesn't really do anything magnificent, you know, for shooters, right? But it looks really awesome.
And yeah, I didn't play 1, but I played Borderlands 2.
Yeah, and how'd you feel about Borderlands 2?
I got bored with it.
You got bored with Borderlands 2. Well, you don't really like looting shit, right?
Yeah, no. I mean, it's a loot. It's Diablo.
It's
Diablo shooting.
That's what I was gonna say. It's fucking Diablo shooting.
Now, a lot of people love Diablo.
That's what I'm saying. So, one of the big things I wanted to go for is not necessarily a game everyone's going to pick as a game you must play.
Yeah.
I like shooters. That's not really a fucking secret. But Borderlands 2 is a funny Diablo shooter,
yeah.
Basically. And Handsome Jack rides a butt pony.
Much what?
He rides a diamond. It's a horse made out of diamonds that he names Butt Stallion.
Okay.
Right? You gotta play that game.
Okay. No, but it's nice because it's got a big open world. It's not like, because like Diablo, yeah. Even Diablo 2, which is as great as the game is, you know, it's basically like it randomly generates sort of like the map, and it really is just a map that you kind of go down a path,
yeah,
to the boss of each with the four
dungeon,
or five zones,
yeah,
in Diablo 2, you know. So but Borderlands 2 has a thing where it's nice, but you can kind of just roam around at your leisure,
go wherever, yeah,
you know. You don't have to be like stuck to, or it's not like even like PSO, which is just a randomly generating zone pathway to it. It's got,
yeah, and my favorite thing about it is that it's big open world that rewards you for going to like these random nooks and crannies, because you meet these characters that are like just mind-bogglingly fun or stupid.
Or weird,
yeah, like Tiny Tina.
Okay, yeah, I remember Tiny Tina. That Tiny Tina was very polarizing. Some people really thought she was funny, and some thought she was cringeworthy as all hell.
Well, what about Scooter?
Scooter.
Catch a ride!
I don't know if I remember.
He wants
Scooter
to bang his cousin.
I remember there was that cool, like, Aussie guy with the big, like, mutton chop stash at the beginning.
Yes.
He was really cool. He came back later in the game. I remember there was, like, yeah, a girl that was, like, the size of a building. She was married or banging some other guy.
Yeah, she bangs, like, all sorts of other dudes that are, like, psychos. But her cousin, Scooter.
Okay.
Because she's the mechanic that makes the big-ass
big
trucks.
Mechanic,
and then Scooter's the guy that makes, like, the fast cars. He wants to bang her really bad. That's why
you
beat her.
That's right.
He sends you over there with, like, you know, a trophy or something.
That's right. I remember that. So they're related?
They are cousins.
That game is so weird.
Yeah. Scooter's big old redneck.
Yeah, because I think, that's really the characters I remember most from that game. I remember Tiny Tina, the girl.
Mad Moxie.
I remember Mad Moxie, but I only did, like, a couple quests. I did a quest for her where she made me go find Ninja Turtles.
Yes.
There's a weird Ninja Turtle quest. It's not really Ninja Turtles, but it's like it's a really funny nod to Ninja Turtles.
It's just one of those games. Well, I mean, it's basically Ninja Turtles, and you get to kill Splinter.
You deliver pizza to mutants in a sewer,
yeah,
and you fight like the guy. Their names are like Leo, Raph, Mikey,
and then you can
Dawn.
Kill Splinter.
Oh yeah, and then like they have the weird thing where if you go further in, like you see like their couch and TV,
yeah,
and shit like that. So I remember that. I mean,
And that game is just wonderful for shit like that. It's clever and funny, and it's just like, it's a game you can spend hours just kind of like chilling out with, you know.
The one thing I kind of liked about the game was I remember the banter from the random grunt enemies was actually kind of funny and clever.
Yeah.
Now, I know that that's kind of like what makes or breaks Borderlands, whether or not you like the humor and style. I think the Birches write it, or Ashley Birch, who does Tiny Tina, and her husband, or whoever, who's like the head writer, something like that. Like, it's a very specific style of humor and whatever. But I like some of it where, you know, I was playing as a chick in the game, and I remember where I'm shooting a bunch of grunts coming out of, like, you know, the spawn points. And they're all, like, yelling, "Billy, get out here! You're missing all the fun!" Like, and, "Kill the hot chick!" Like, they're just, that's their orders. So yeah. And they're screaming down to kill you. So it's kind of like, it's a little more alive, self-aware, rather than just, you know, a little imp that goes, "Ing-ing-ing," comes out of a spawn point, you kill it, and it's whatever. It's like, you're actually killing crazy dudes, and they actually do talk amongst each other.
Well, I mean, like, you light a guy on fire, and he screams, "I smell delicious!" And then dies.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, like, the way it was sold to me is it was basically a hilarious Mad Max. The first game was sold to me like, "Oh, it's Mad Max cel-shaded." And I was like, "Oh, okay, I'll check it out." I mean, that doesn't encompass it at all. It's just, like, it really does have that style of, like, Mad Max out on the wasteland. It obviously takes a lot from Mad Max. So that's cool. And so what do you think is your number five?
I would say Chrono Trigger.
Chrono Trigger.
So Chrono Trigger is an RPG, came out late in the Super NES's life, so it's past Final Fantasy VI. So the graphically, it actually looks way above most every other Super NES RPG, the traditional RPG, that is.
Okay.
Character sprites are larger, more detailed. But what makes Chrono Trigger so good is that it's both, guys, it's more simple than a lot of RPGs tend to be nowadays, or maybe a little smaller, but at the same time, it's more endearing in a certain sort of. So it's basically Jules Verne / H.G. Wells' story of time travel and stuff like that. And what makes it great is that, you know, the characters are immediately kind of funny and relatable right off the bat. And the way it slowly builds up to where it's going is good. It's got this nice incline where it doesn't start with, like, a humongous bang, but it starts with, like, you know, pretty intriguing plot, and, you know, just like, you know, your first, you know, leg of the game is a good enough story where you're intrigued, and then it grows into something even bigger, and then it becomes, like, really, really intriguing from there. And it's got probably the best soundtrack of all time by Yasunori Mitsuda, who gave himself stomach ulcers working so hard on it.
You think that's a better soundtrack than Castlevania Symphony of the Night?
Absolutely.
Really?
120% better. I like Castlevania Symphony of the Night soundtrack, but Chrono Trigger, and by extension Chrono Cross, which don't want to talk about that much, are the best video game and possibly any soundtracks, period.
Wow, okay.
And I like, the other thing I like about Chrono Trigger is it actually takes into account certain things, like, okay, so if you don't do this and beat the game, like, the ending will be different. Or you can actually go, because it's a time travel game, you can go face the end boss at any point. And depending on how much you've affected people and lives in all the different time periods, will greatly reflect on the ending.
Wow.
So it actually takes into account weird shit like that. I actually really like that about it. So it's got replayability. It's got a simple-to-learn combat system that kind of, like, it's got a nice stacking, is the more you play, the more techs you learn, the more attacks you learn, and then, like, you get interested, because if who you pair up in battle means what you start learning, dual techs and triple techs, and that's really neat.
Didn't you play this later in life, too?
I played Chrono Trigger the first time I actually sat down and beat Chrono Trigger. It was 2011.
Oh, okay, yeah. I told Max he needs to play that, because he loves...
That's the thing. I'm not someone who played Chrono Trigger in 1995, and it was my first RPG, and so therefore it is the best, because that's everyone has that first fuck syndrome with RPGs, where the first one they play is their favorite. Chrono Trigger is not the first one I played. It's still one of my favorites. I still think it's one of the best. In fact, I think it's the best game Square Enix has ever made. And short of a couple games, they've never really come close to Chrono Trigger level of greatness since it came out, which to me is a little like, get your shit together, Square, but, you know, at the same time, it is that good. So, yeah.
I have to amend one of mine, because I forgot all the Game Boy and Game Boy Advance games shit. So for my number four, I'm going to go Tactics Ogre.
Tactics Ogre is a really good game.
Tactics Ogre is a fucking phenomenal game. I can't believe I forgot about it. It was my first turn-based strategy game I ever played. Mm-hmm. My brother bought it, made by Atlas Games, which I think it was its last... Wasn't it Atlas Games last... It was like their last-ditch effort before they went bankrupt, wasn't it?
Oculus exists. They're still... Oculus
I think at the time, the big thing about it
they
was...
They exist, proliferated, and then just got bought by Sega. So...
Okay.
But that was like a year ago. They existed and went on, and...
I remember there being something about it because, like, they expected Tactics Ogre to be Atlus's last game.
Mm.
There was a big thing about it. I mean, even Rodney talked about it forever, but...
Well, the problem was is the company that made it got absorbed by Enix, and then that got stuck into the Square Enix.
Okay, that makes
sense.
So
that whole company's...
Because Final Fantasy Tactics came out after
that.
Well,
yeah, but it's all... The guy who started all that tactic was from the Ogre.
Okay.
So it all kind of came from the same place. So if you liked Final Fantasy Tactics and anything in the evilist world of Final Fantasy, it's from the Ogre Battle Tactics Ogre people. So that's why there's
that makes
that
sense. Okay. Yeah, my brother bought himself a copy and he was all like, he just decided to buy me a copy. He was like, I know you're going to love this. And that was the game that broke my Game Boy Advance. Like, I played
Rage?
The shit out. No. I got it, and up until then, like, I had a bunch of games, but I didn't really play the shit out of my Game Boy Advance. And I had the Taco one, you know,
the
flip one.
I had
both. I liked the Taco one, it was more comfortable to play on than the little flip one, but the flip one had a better screen. But that game I played, I can remember logging at least 40 or some odd, maybe even more hours into that game. And unfortunately, like, I can't really remember, like, the main story to it or anything. I just remember that it was one of the best strategy games I've ever played. And I think just it was so well balanced and stuff. And I think there was one... On my second playthrough, I got to this battle where I accidentally fucked up and I put the wrong set of people in. And I could never beat it. So that is where it sat for the last, like, 10 years.
Wow.
In that, yeah, I probably have it somewhere. Your number four.
My number four, interestingly enough, is the exact same genre as Tactics Ogre, which is Shining Force 3, Scenario 1 through 3, for the Sega Saturn. Now, it's the exact same play style as Tactics Ogre, which is a turn-based strategy game. You know, you move, like, square by square.
Yeah, square by square.
And, you know, you have different types of units. You have, like, you know, people who have arrows or swords or lances.
Dragoons with, yeah.
But, you know. All that stuff. But Shining Force 3, Scenario 1 through 3, is a game that's very, very hard for any native English speaker to play. Because Sega only translated Scenario 1. Now, it's three games. And how it basically works is it's this very Game of Thrones, way before Game of Thrones style setup, where you have a Republic, an Empire, and then, you know, they're kind of like in this sort of uneasy sort of not even alliance, just coexistence, and then that is all starting to break down. And in the first game, you play as the son of one of the lords of the Republic. And then the second game, Scenario 2, which takes place at the same time as the first game, you play as the third prince of the Empire, everything from his angle, his point of view. And then the third game, you play as a mercenary, which starts at the midway point through Scenario 1 and 2, and then continues past that, because there's more to it than just the Empire and the Republic. There's also a whole secret sect of people, the Bolzum monks, who are basically trying to manipulate everything to their own ends.
Yeah.
And then that's all even more. There's even more story to that in a game that was released previously called Shining the Holy Ark. But those games are so good, and they're so detailed, and they got lots of story. The only way to actually play, you can do it, but it takes some doing. You're going to need to either mod a Saturn or basically download a lot of notebooks or have a desktop of the way you play. Because the website Shining Force Central translated Scenario 2 and 3.
Oh,
and
wow.
And they did a really good job of visualizing the script so you know where you are. And you can follow, because like it has like a character portrait, and they put the character portrait next to the translated line of dialogue each line so you can follow along. And that's how I did it.
Yeah.
On a big printout, on a notebook printout. But it was just really good, and it had a lot of really cool features where, like, in Scenario 1, you're in this volcano in a late battle. And if you decide to basically knock this one stalagmite down or knock this one thing over, you'll open up an area in the second game because you go through the same volcano at a different point later on. And if you've done something that's affected the landscape in that area on one side, it'll affect the other side when you go through it again.
Wow.
And in, like, the second battle of the game, there's two archers, these brothers, and basically, if one of them, like, if you get both of them to live, one will join your party, one will go off on his own. Now, you can have one of them both die, and then nobody gets them, or, like, basically, it's like the blue-haired archer will always, if you save him, he will at some point be alive in the story of the second game, which is, you know, same time as the first.
Yeah.
But he'll join the second game's party, and then if you save the green-haired guy to Hayward, he'll join your party immediately.
So it all takes place in the same battle, kind of?
It's like the first two games are literally parallel.
Time-wise.
And the third game starts at the midpoint of 1 and 2 and then continues past it. But at the end of the third game, it takes all your save data from both games. At the end of the third game, when you're doing like the big last battle, you basically are controlling three armies. And it switches between three different battlefields, and it's all the characters you've leveled up. And every character in your army is a character with a specific character design and backstory.
Wow.
And personality and everything.
So it sounds like they put a lot of detail into it.
Oh yeah, it is my by far like the magnum opus for turn-based RPGs. That's my favorite turn-based RPG. I have all of them. I have this exclusive premium disc. That was only given out to people in Japan who got in contact with the developer. It is a fantastic game, and very few people have ever played it. Very few people ever will play it because...
Well, in the States. I
mean. Yeah, because again, Scenario 2 and 3 were never translated officially, and Sega is Sega, and they're like, they're the worst, second only to Konami. So...
Hashtag fuck Sega.
You're probably never going to get to play it any other way than finding rare Japanese copies and just going by a translation guide.
You think they would carry that at, like, GameCube?
They've occasionally had stuff it. Like that. So, yeah, if you have, like, some of those large second-hand game shops, it's possible to run into any of the games. They're not cheap. They're going to run you about $100+ for each scenario. And then that's not even counting the premium disc, which is just, like, a bonus thing, fun thing with, like a super hard dungeon. But, yeah, I mean, it is a fantastic experience and a very... interesting, very intricately woven, complex storyline.
Well, I mean, it kind of reminds me of one of the things that I really loved about Resident Evil 2, I want to say, where there's two storylines.
Yeah, there's A and B.
The scenarios that take place at the same time, just different parts of the city.
Yeah.
I've always liked that kind of game. So it's kind of an interesting... it's a drawing effect for me. That's something that would be like, oh shit, the story's complex and it takes place at the same time as each other. I would play all three just for that.
And the thing is, it's not like it's a short game. It is three
full size games
on three separate discs that are bought separately. So it's like, and they all came out within like a month or two of each other in Japan. So, but again, we only got one scenario, and they kind of fudged the ending a bit because they knew they weren't going to translate the rest of them. So, it's one of those really, like, fuck Sega, man.
Fucking Sega. So for my number three, probably a lot of people played this, and, you know, I have a really silly reason as to why I think everyone should play it. Red Dead Redemption. One, I think it has one of the... I mean, it'll piss you off, but it has one of the coolest endings.
Yes.
I think, in the last...
ending or the true ending? Because there's, like... Well... There's, like, ending, and then there's true ending to the game.
Isn't... I don't know if... Well, I don't think anyone's going to do shit. True ending is where you run out and try to fight your way out, right?
True... No, that's ending.
Oh, that's ending?
That's the ending.
Oh,
then
shit.
Then there's true ending to the game. And both are pretty good.
What's true ending to the game?
So true ending, you take over and start playing the game as your son 4 years later.
Oh, yes, no, I did, yes, okay, I know what you're talking about. Yeah
and if and it's not pointed out like it's a main story quest, because there are none. It's just, you have to just randomly find this one guy who's like looks like a regular quest, but if you follow this regular quest pathway as the son of the main character, you can get to the real true ending, where the title comes up on the screen, and then it goes to credits.
Yeah.
Like, there's a true ending to Red Dead Redemption, and both are really good, actually.
Both are fantastic, and the reason I think everybody should play this is because they make cowboys cool again. Like, I know, like, cowboys have always been cool, but, like, this game, fucking Red Dead Revolver did it, too. It was kind of cool, but, like, Red Dead Redemption... made cowboys cool, and multiplayer in Red Dead Redemption was fucking fantastic.
There was a lot of fun there. One thing I think was really good about Red Dead Redemption was that there's a lot of things about it that I really liked, Like, it was very accurate to history because the game takes place in 1911.
Yeah.
You don't run into any Indian tribes in the game because by 1911
there were basically that
whole idea was gone.
Yeah.
You do see Native Americans in the game, but you don't see Indian tribes.
Yeah.
And no. I thought, wow, that's very accurate. And then the game takes place along the Arizona New Mexico border in the same time when they weren't states yet.
Yeah.
And it's got a lot of good stuff. And then one thing I really liked, is maybe this is because the game was literally made in San Diego, is that they really did a good job of showing how different the environments in the desert can be, especially the American Southwest.
Yeah.
Because it's not just like dirt and cactus.
Yeah.
There actually are significant differences, even though
there's dry deciduous forests.
Yeah, there's all kinds. And they actually show all the different types of environments that are in that part of the world. And maybe it's because the studio was literally there, but I appreciated that a lot because we grew up our whole lives in SoCal.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like we know the huge difference in landscapes that do occur even within one type of area.
You know what another thing that I really loved about that game? One, it did third person right. It really did it. It was smooth. It did look...
It was a looker, too. Really, yeah. It was a game that really made you, okay, this is why I bought a 360, you know?
Yeah, and you know what? The guns, all the guns felt awesome. And they felt different, at least
from
what I
remember.
Yeah,
once you got the 1911 pistol...
There was no point in playing anything.
Again, the game takes place in 1911, and you might think, why do I have a modern-looking hand pistol? Well, remember, the guy who's the government...
Browning, yeah, no.
You know, special agent who gives it to you, it's a 1911. Why do you think the gun's called that?
Yeah, no, that's one of my favorite things in the game, because there was a bunch of people that were like, oh, man, they wouldn't have this gun, this gun's modern, blah, blah, blah. I was like, bitch, that was designed in 1910. It came out in 1911.
And that's why it's called that.
It was made for the
Army.
It's
another really good nod to real history. So.
They even have the BAR, don't they? They have the Browning Assault Rifle.
I don't remember... Because I really...
No, they don't have that in the game, I don't think. But that would have been around that time the Browning Assault Rifle would have come out. And that would have been a game changer, too. Nobody would have been using the fucking Winchester anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, that game's a must-play. If only for the awesome historical nods. But the ending is so worth it. It's so worth it. Number three for you.
Number three for me. I'm probably going to go with Banjo-Kazooie.
Yeah, okay.
I know this was one of yours as well. Banjo-Kazooie to me is the pinnacle of platformers. Like, Mario 64 started it, don't get me wrong. Mario 64 is the revolutionary, the game changer.
Well, Mario 64 is the first platformer that I played.
First
3D platformer.
Yeah, it's the first good 3D platformer.
Yeah.
And it's a game changer, and I can fully acknowledge that. But I think Banjo-Kazooie was better. And I think two good reasons why Banjo-Kazooie was better was, one, it had a better hub world with more interesting secrets and stuff to discover. And two, Banjo-Kazooie had the advantage of, barring exactly one puzzle piece, you could go into a world and get everything in that world right away. No being sent out of the world and then
having to come back.
And now, granted, that makes it so like they couldn't alter the landscape as much as, say, Mario 64 could, but they didn't do it that much in Mario 64, and you did alter stuff as you went through it. But I liked how it was, you went into the game world, it was an enormous game level, and you could do everything in there as long as you were thorough and diligent enough.
Yeah.
And then you could leave and never have to go back there. So you could avoid backtracking completely in Banjo-Kazooie if you were diligent enough.
Yeah, one of the big things for me that I picked Banjo-Kazooie for was, one, the music.
The music's fucking fantastic. Awesome. Grant Kirkhope, who's now a local.
That's right.
He's a really cool dude. I ran into him.
He's like local too. Right?
Yeah, yeah. He's actually very close to us.
Not just LA. He's up here.
I ran into him at E3 one year. He was a fantastic dude to talk to. He really loves his fans and all that. But yeah, it's got this really good...
Fucking good music, yeah.
Really good haunting quality. Not haunting, but like fairy tale dream-like quality. Which is funny because the game was called Project Dream.
Yeah.
You know, way before it became what it is today, but...
And way before they had some nightmarish idea for a game named Dream.
Dreams. No, but it was... And I liked what he did where he had the different... what's the word? But it had like the... where if you were in the game world and played the soundtrack, you went underwater and it would play like a harmonic or a harp-like version, an underwater variation, and it would like morph into it and then morph back when you left it, stuff like that.
And wasn't that kind of dynamic. Like the first game that really...
Like, it had a really good dynamic music.
You know what else it had? Fucking awesome characters. It had awesome characters, and they weren't really, like, they didn't have to be super fleshed out.
Yeah.
They were just really fun. They were really fun.
Fun, cheeky.
Mumbo Jumbo.
Yeah.
Who doesn't love that guy?
And he would play pranks on you and stuff. And
yeah.
He'd be like, oh, I'll turn you into a T-Rex. I'll save that for the next game.
Yeah. That was, like, back when Rare was really killing it.
It has the best level in a 3D platformer ever, which was Click Clockwork.
Yeah, which brings my number two all time. Because that's our number, that was my number. I guess that would have been my number two, huh?
Yeah.
Well, okay, so my number two, since we're sharing, it turns out we share two in common. Conker's Bad Fur Day.
It's another Rare platformer from the era, but it's actually very different from Banjo in the style and structure, really.
It is, and it's, you know what, it's not smoothly made. I mean, if you go back and play it now, the controls are clunky and, you know, like, it's just, it's nowhere as nice as Banjo-Kazooie, but you could even say that about the story, too. The reason I love it is that it seemed like the game they made blowing off steam from all the other stuff that they had. And so the game has, like, every time you go into a new world, the game changes completely in tone. You know, like, you have parts where you go in and become a World War II shooter, and then it switches from World War II shooter in that same world to slightly horror game-esque with the teddy bears and shit that are, like, in that one lab and stuff.
Yeah.
I really dug that. Also, it had awesome music.
Yep.
Had great enemies.
Robin Beanland did the music. He told me a little bit about the behind the scenes of that at E3 this year, which was really cool.
Oh, cool.
That game is interesting to me. I never actually played through it. I didn't like how it was a little bit more slippery than Banjo. The way Conker would slip a little bit around.
Yeah.
A little more, but it's just, it was hard to get when it came out. Because they didn't make very many copies of it.
Oh, yeah, no. I mean, I got it totally by accident, actually. I went and bought Cruisin' USA.
Oh, yeah.
It was on sale at Blockbuster, and someone had switched the insides of it.
No way.
Yeah, and then I went back, and I was like, I loved the game, but, like, I went back, and because it wasn't running very well, because it was, like, being janky, and I went back, and Blockbuster actually had a copy of Conker's Bad Fur Day. And so what I did is I said I wanted to buy this game. You guys gave me Cruisin' USA, and so they gave me a new cartridge of Conker's, and I played the shit out of that game. And then I bought the remake, which is more censored than the original.
Odd.
But I bought the remake, yeah.
Which is a weird, weird fucking thing.
Yeah, and the remake had really great multiplayer. But all right, so you're number two
now? Yeah, I'm number two in one of the greatest games of all time, Resident Evil 4. Resident Evil 4 is, I've talked a lot about that game, but it's yes, it is the game that sort of sent Resident Evil down the path that, you know, is on now, which is not great, but that's not Resident Evil 4's fault.
No.
The thing is this.
That's the audience's fault.
Resident Evil's classic style, I feel, had really worn out its welcome by the point 4 was coming along. Because you had 1, 2, 3, Veronica, 0,
Bro.
And Remake. And they were all
varying
degrees of good or bad, depending on how you feel about it. But there wasn't much... It had done everything you could do. Like, how much more could you really do in that classic style? Like, I'm sure some people would argue there's a lot more they could do. But I feel like the series was starting to sell less and less. Not just because it went on to GameCube. I mean, whether it was on PS2 or GameCube, it was not selling at the peak of, say, Resident Evil 2 or Resident
I'm happy
3.
It went to GameCube.
But, you know, it needed to reinvigorate itself. And it started and stopped production 4 times. Started as one thing, became Devil May Cry, and then went through 3 whole different iterations before Shinji Mikami, the original creator of Resident Evil, took kind of like a demotion, came in and said, okay, I'll direct this game. And he started from scratch again, and I think it did all these things right. It gutted out the original plot line that the games were running on, and it was kind of just going nowhere with.
Yeah.
And it created a whole new villain and a whole new viral story.
An excellent villain, too.
But it also was like, you know, these things are... This whole series is silly, but, like, let's not make fun of ourselves, but let's kind of be self-aware that this is kind of... This is kind of, like, ridiculous. Fucking ridiculous. But let's have fun with it at the same time. And, you know, it did everything that it needed to do. And then, and on top of that, it fucking game changed the whole third person shooter genre. So it was, and to this day is, an excellently, masterfully paced game.
It really is. I mean, one of my favorite things about it is that you had to actively choose to stand and fight or run.
Yeah.
And when you had to run, like, there was no, like, backing up very fast. No, you had to turn your back on these crazy motherfuckers and run and just hope they're not catching up to you. I thought that was just... That was one of the freakiest parts of the game, and I feel like it's just a small thing that they might not have actively chosen to do that. Maybe that was just, like, a little random thing, but it made the game for me. I think the only downside to the game, and it's not even a big downside because you can throw her in a garbage can if you need to, is that you have to babysit someone.
And she's constantly...
She stays with you.
Like, one, she's not with you much of the game.
Yeah.
She's constantly... Even when you get her, she's constantly being, like, story-wise taken away.
Yeah.
And then you get her back and she's taken away. So it's like, she's not with you. She'll duck when you're aiming at her and she'll go in a trash can if you're near the trash can, like a hiding spot.
Yeah.
I don't buy any complaints that she was a nuisance or in the way, because you actually had to kind of try to shoot her, because if she died, it was kind of your own damn fault.
Well, like I said, like, if I had a complaint, it would be that it's an escort mission, and I fucking hate escort missions, really.
But only for a small portion of the game itself.
Correct. I'm literally just throwing this out there as a, if there's a complaint to be made, it's the only complaint, really.
But then it had great bonus content with the mercenaries.
It did. Mercenaries was really cool.
But yeah, I think what people don't get, and what Capcom really doesn't get, is the pacing. And how it goes from where it starts, and then it's constantly throwing new types of experiences at you, constantly.
Yeah.
New types of enemies, new types of bosses, new types of encounters, events. It is not literally just, hey, we'll just put you in a new area and just kind of like, here's a wave, here's a wave, here's a wave. It's not like that. Like, you go to the castle, and you start the castle, and people are throwing catapults at you.
Yeah.
So then you get through that, and then you get inside the castle. You get inside the castle, and then you have to start dealing with monks that have a new type of thing coming out of their head.
Yeah.
Okay, you get through that, not a big deal. But then you have to get a key. But to get a key, you have to go down to the dungeon where there's this new type of enemy who's blind, and he has the big claws.
Yeah.
And you have to use the bells to get him to run and hit the bells, and then hit the thing on his back.
Can we talk about how they reinvent... Like, Resident Evil has always had a pretty good atmosphere, but I don't think I think Resident Evil 4 was like the pinnacle of atmosphere in an action horror.
Yeah.
Because it still felt like you were way out of your depth. Like you were basically lost in the fog in that game.
But you weren't helpless either.
No, you weren't helpless, but like it definitely felt, there was like a sense of helplessness in that game, even though like you're basically a one-man fucking army in that game, but you know, there was still, like, they did a really good job of, like, giving you this sense of foreboding throughout the entire game. And then you get to 5, and 5 is just a fucking action.
Yeah. Well, they do that thing, too, where if you pay attention to the story, they say they, like, send a helicopter and it gets shot down or whatever.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of like, well, we're trying to send help to you, but, you know, you're way out of the way, like, off the grid kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then, eventually, throughout the game, a helicopter does make it there. And it's a big fucking army helicopter.
Yeah.
And you get this sort of moment where, again, it's a completely new experience where you're running through, like, this military base camp. But, hey, this big fucking helicopter comes in and just fucking launching machine gun and missile fire all over the fucking...
Because they're taking this shit seriously.
And it's like the game doesn't always have, like, this, it's constantly getting worse. Like, just constantly pounding you, making you feel shittier and shittier. And it does this moment where it's, like, all of a sudden you feel empowered because you got this aerial support that's just fucking wrecking everything.
Well, it's got hills and dips and stuff. It's good. It's got a good flow. I like that.
It's like a nice breathing room moment where it's like you all of a sudden you feel empowered for a bit.
Yeah. I mean, so that was my number one pick. That was going to be my number one. Everybody needs to fucking play that game.
Well, the funny thing about that, Resident Evil 4 and being number one, was there was a 100th issue or so of Nintendo Power. And this was in 2005.
Yeah.
Like June 2005. And they said Resident Evil 4 was their number two pick of all time. And some people immediately in the following issues were complaining. They're like, how can you say Resident Evil 4 is like the number two best game of all time? And it's only been out for like 5 months. They're like, it's Resident Evil 4.
Have you fucking played it?
It's like, it's Resident Evil fucking 4.
I
like,
beat that game 8 times.
Yeah, I've probably easily done the same. My number one pick is like a Zelda, it would be a Zelda game for me.
Yeah.
I truly feel that is the best game. That's the game I think
saw this coming.
Every single person on the planet needs to play through one of the good Zelda games.
Yeah.
I'm unable to really say which is definitively the best. Like, I think Ocarina of Time is one of the best, is the best game ever made. I feel Link to the Past.
Well, I've also played Ocarina of Time.
You know, I feel Link to the Past is the best game ever made too. But my favorite Zelda game, personally, is Link's Awakening. Link's Awakening is my, because Link's Awakening kind of does everything that Link to the Past did, but then it added the best game story ever on top of it.
And that's one I have to play.
And the reason I think it's so good is because it's fucking subtle. I like subtlety. I think a lot of people, when they talk about the best story in a game, is a story that has these really hammered home emotional beats.
Steve? is that who you're saying that?
No, I'm saying in general, like like most people, where it's like when they talk about, you know, the big emotionally story-driven games that made them feels and shit, all of those games may have good stories, but they all beat you over the fucking head with their emotional beats. Like,
yeah.
It was made to be an emotional scene. Link's Awakening is a game that sort of presents a fucking story, and it's what you take away from it. It's truly what is closest to the definition of art, where it's not about, you know, I'm not trying to say something, it's what do you take away from this?
Yeah.
And the story is so good because it has a really emotional and you know, heart-wrenching core to it, but that's only if that's what you take away from it. Because a lot of people played it and just didn't fucking get it.
Well, isn't that the one where, like, basically you can choose to kill a
There's no choice. There's no choice in the game. It has its story and presents it, and it's whatever the fuck you take from it.
Oh, at the end you kind of decide whether, or you have to decide for yourself what actually...
Yeah, well, there's no decision game. I mean, there's no,
yeah, no
do this or that.
Yeah, no, I know.
It's like, you play the game, you do
what
the story.
What I mean by decide for yourself, I mean, is like, you determine what you take away from it, basically.
Yeah, yeah. You get the ending, and it's like, whatever you took away from it. But, and the other thing that's one is I love subtlety, and the other thing I really love, and this is probably why I kind of like the Fable games, even though I don't think they did it as well, nearly as well, is moral complexities.
Yeah.
When you have a puzzle for your brain, where it's like, here's this weird fucking moral choice, but it is so fucking hard to know which is the right one. Like, you are just in this moral quandary as well.
Yeah.
I love that. I love having that fucking brain-twisting, Jesus Christ, I don't know which is the right answer. I don't know if, you know, what I did was the right thing. I love that. That is what I love the most. And Link's Awakening probably gives one of the best, if not the best, moral quandary. Because, like, Fable 2 did it too, where it's like you go to the Shadow Court and there's that girl who's been kidnapped, and it's like,
yeah,
do you let them take her like youth and everything, or do you like give up your own and become this ugly, like hollow looking haggard thing so that she can, you know, escape and live and whatever. And that's kind of cool, you know, because they do this thing where, like, choose now, whatever. It's not like Link's Awakening where there is no choice. It's, you fucking did this.
How do you feel about
how do you feel about it? You know, whatever you took away from it, like, boy, what did I do in that game? Was that the right thing or not? I don't know. And there's no right answer. And I'm trying to fucking arrange. I've been trying for years to arrange an interview with the game's writer, Yoshiaki Koizumi. But, like, Nintendo never fucking gets back to me on it. They say they will, but they never do.
what system is that for?
Game Boy.
Which Game Boy?
It came out on the original Game Boy in 1993.
Damn.
Yeah.
Oh, it's an old one.
Oh, it's old. It's old and black and white. There's a color version, DX, came out in 1998. But yeah, it's old.
Okay. I was thinking this was a new one. When did Link to the Past come out?
92, I think. 91, 92.
Damn. All right.
Link's Awakening is 93.
All right, guys. So that was our each of our five games. For me, it ended up being three because we shared two. But
yeah, we shared two.
You know, thanks for hanging out with us. Let us know on Twitter or on the comments what your guys' five favorite games that you feel everyone should play or your thoughts on the ones we picked. We'll catch you next time.
All right.
Shine on, dudes. As always, dudes, hit me up on Twitter with questions and comments, at FunkMachine with a PH. Take a look at our YouTube channel, youtube.com/user/yovideogames, and if you have a chance, rate us and comment on iTunes and Stitcher. Have a good one, dudes.